This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book, The Inquisition Revealed, in its origin, policy, cruelties, and history, with memoirs of its victims in France, Spain, Portugal, Italy, England, India, and other countries. By Thomas Timpson. Dedication. Dedication. To His Eminence Cardinal Wiseman. My Lord Cardinal. Roman Catholics and Protestants are alike interested in this volume, designed, as it is, to advance pure Christianity. They have an equal right to profess their own peculiar faith and to propagate their religious opinions. But in the free exercise of that right, they are equally bound by every principle of justice and charity to cherish towards each other mutual esteem and benevolence. Romanists, however, do not admit the Holy Scriptures as the sole authority in religion, and their principles will not allow them, therefore, to grant toleration to those who dissent from them. Their intolerance arises from the policy of the hierarchy and the reception of unscriptural traditions. Hence their illiberality in Italy, Sardinia, Spain, Portugal, the Brazils, and other countries, where the priesthood is dominant. Hence the inveterate hostility of the Romish priests against the popular reading of the Bible. Their people are kept thus in ignorance, deluded by false doctrines, and theirs being not exclusively the principles of the Holy Scriptures, cannot be the religion of our Lord Jesus Christ. My Lord Cardinal, every Briton should understand the character and claims of the papacy. For, as predicted in the oracles of God, Protestants hold that Popery is the man of sin, the mystery of iniquity, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth, drunken with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus, 2 Thess. 3-7, Reverend XVII. 5-6. Every British Christian is deeply interested in studying the doctrines of Popery, its priestly power, absolution, transubstantiation, tradition, and purgatory, and in considering its evil doings in auricular confession, penance, Mariolatry, priestly celibacy, spiritual domination, and the Inquisition. The history of these is the condemnation of Popery. This volume contains the substance of the valuable works of Limborch, Urente, Dellen, Gavin, Buchanan, Bauer, Newton, Gibbon, Watson, Rank, Sismondi, Jones, Puigblanche, Edgar, Elliot, Mendham, Giesler, Dowling, Daubigny, De Castro, Achille, and many others regarding the Inquisition. This volume is designed as an antidote to Popery, especially as a present to young persons, and it is believed by judicious friends to be most seasonable to instruct inquirers and to advance the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Having these objects in view, this work is dedicated, with due respect, to Your Eminence by the author. End of dedication. Chapter 1. Popery as predicted in Scripture. The Court of Inquisition cruel and execrable, Christianity benevolent, the Inquisition predicted, 2 Thess. 3:41-IV. 1-3, Reverend XVII. 1-18, Comments by Elliot, B.P., Newton, and Scott. Religion, as taught by the Romish priesthood, has been enforced and guarded by pains and penalties during many ages. For the last 6 centuries, this has been done chiefly by a court, denominated in all countries where it has been established, the Holy Inquisition. But this court has been execrated in every country in which it has existed, as the most dreadful, cruel, and sanguinary of all tribunals, even by professors of the faith of Rome. Still, It is supported by the papal hierarchy, as the agents of the Pope may be able to obtain permission of the governments who observe the Romish religion. Christianity has thus been dishonored in the assumption of its sacred name by Roman Catholics, while they have practiced these cruelties, so contrary to the letter and to the spirit of the religion of Jesus Christ. For all his principles and precepts manifest divine benevolence, as chanted at the birth of the Redeemer, by a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God, and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, good will towards men." Christianity is the religion of love, and like its ever-blessed author, the Son of God. God is love, and he that dwelleth in love dwelleth in God, and God in him. It enjoins upon all its professors the practice of benevolence. It requires them to possess and exemplify that spirit. Its moral code is comprehended in that summary of the divine law, as given by our Savior: "Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. And thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself." Its chief practical maxim is, "Whatsoever ye would that men should do to you, do ye even so to them, for this is the law and the prophets." These precepts were followed by the early believers of the gospel, constraining the heathen to admire their benevolence, exclaiming, "See how these Christians love one another." False teachers, however, having corrupted the doctrines and ordinances of Christ, were influenced by another spirit, and, in the course of a few ages, the professed ministers of the loving Redeemer exhibited intolerance, malevolence, and cruelty, exceeding what had ever been witnessed under any form of religion. These enormities have been seen chiefly in the operations of the Roman Catholics, and especially by their execrable Court of Inquisition, as this has been established in Spain, France, Portugal, India, and Rome. This court, though denominated holy, has been the most arbitrary, inhuman, and sanguinary that ever existed among men, and because of its enormities, by its various machinery and by its savage armies, it is symbolized in the Holy Scriptures under the emblem of a harlot, deluding the nations with her intoxicating draughts, and herself drunken with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus, Reverend XVII. 6. Before we enter upon the direct history of the Inquisition, therefore, it will be necessary to notice the inspired prophecies relating to this apostate and cruel hierarchy of popery, and to take a brief review of the rise and progress of that terrible and hated system of Antichrist. Known unto God are all his works from the beginning of the world, and equally foreseen were all the forms of falsehood, cruelty, and evil upon the earth. Hence the inspired predictions concerning the hateful enemy of Christ. Our blessed Lord repeatedly admonished his disciples concerning false teachers who would be distinguished by their inhumanity, and the Apostle Paul, in correcting the mistakes of some, regarding the day of judgment as being near, says, "Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come, except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition, who opposeth and exalteth himself above all that is called God, or that is worshipped, so that he, as God, sitteth in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God." 2 Thess. 3:4. Again he represents the character of Romish teachers, and says, "Now the Spirit speaketh expressly, that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils, speaking lies in hypocrisy, having their conscience seared with a hot iron, forbidding to marry, and commanding to abstain from meats, which God hath created to be received with thanksgiving of them who believe and know the truth." 1 Tim. IV 1-3. Still more remarkable is the prediction described by the Apostle John. And there came one of the seven angels which had the seven vials, and talked with me, saying unto me, Come hither, I will show unto thee the judgment of the great whore that sitteth upon many waters, with whom the kings of the earth have committed fornication, and the inhabitants of the earth have been made drunk with the wine of her fornication. So he carried me away in the spirit into the wilderness, and I saw a woman sit upon a scarlet-colored beast, full of names of blasphemy, having seven heads and 10 horns. And the woman was arrayed in purple and scarlet color, and decked with gold and precious stones and pearls, having a golden cup in her hand full of abominations and filthiness of her fornication. And upon her forehead was a name written, Mystery, Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots and abominations of the earth. And I saw the woman drunken with the blood of the saints, and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus. And when I saw her, I wondered with great admiration. And the angel said unto me, Wherefore dost thou marvel? I will tell thee the mystery of the woman, and of the beast that carrieth her, which hath the 7 heads and 10 horns. The beast that thou essayest was, and is not, and shall ascend out of the bottomless pit, and go into perdition. The 7 heads are 7 mountains, on which the woman sitteth. And there are 7 kings. And the 10 horns which thou essayest are 10 kings, who have received no kingdom as yet, but receive power as kings 1 hour with the beast. These shall make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb shall overcome them, for he is Lord of lords and King of kings, and they that are with him are called, and chosen, and faithful. And he saith unto me, The waters which thou essayest, where the whore sitteth, are peoples, and multitudes, and nations, and tongues. And the woman whom thou essayest is that great city, which reigneth over the kings of the earth, Reverend XVII. 1-18. All these several predictions have been fulfilled with the most striking completeness, and we may have to refer to them in the course of this work. But the descriptions in those from the Revelation require our very special notice, as they lead us more particularly to the Romish hierarchy and to the terrible court of Inquisition. The Reverend Mr. Eliot, in his commentary on this chapter, says, This vision represented pictorially a gaudily dressed drunken harlot, seated on a beast of monstrous form, with 7 heads, and on the 7th 10 horns. The beast, in respect of its body, depicted the papal empire of the 10 Western European kingdoms, and in respect of the 7th, or rather 8th head, the succession of Roman popes, constituting, from after the 6th century, that empire's spiritual rulers. So the woman represented Rome in its character of the papal see and mother church of Western Christendom, including, doubtless, as part and parcel of herself, the ecclesiastical state, or Peter's patrimony in Italy, and vast dominions, convents, churches, and other property appertaining to the papal church elsewhere, both in Europe and over the world. 1. As the beast's body both upheld and was subject to the woman, the rider, so the empire as a whole, with the power of its secular kingdoms and many peoples, upheld and was also at the same time ruled by papal Rome, the mother church of Christendom. 2. As the woman was here depicted before St. John, under a double character, viz., as a harlot to the 10 kings, and a vintner or tavern hostess vending wines to the common people, just according to the custom of earlier times, in which the harlot and the hostess of a tavern were characters frequently united, so the Church of Rome answered to the symbol in either point of view, interchanging mutual favors, such as might suit their respective characters, with the kings of anti-Christendom, and to the common people dealing out for sale the wine of the poison of her fornication, her indulgences, relics, transubstantiation cup, as if the cup of salvation, in circa. See the Pope's own medal, holding out the cup of her apostasy, struck at Rome on occasion of the Jubilee in 1825, therewith drugging and making them besotted and drunk. 3. With regard to the portraiture of the woman, robed in purple and scarlet, and adorned with gold, and precious stones and pearls, it is, as applied to the Romish church, a picture, characteristic and from life. The dress specified being distinctively that of the Romish ecclesiastical dignitaries, and the ornaments those with which it has been bedecked beyond any church called Christian, nay, beyond any religion, probably, that has ever existed in the world, not to add that even the very name on the harlot's forehead, Mystery, a name allusive, evidently, to St. Paul's predicted mystery of iniquity, was one, if we may repose credit on no vulgar authority, once written on the Pope's tiara, and the apocalyptic title, Mother of Harlots and of the Abominations of the Earth, the very parody, if I may so say, of the title Rome arrogates to herself, Rome, Mother and Mistress. 4. As to the harlots being depicted, drunken with the blood of the saints, its applicability to the Romish Church, throughout the latter half, at least portion of the beast's 1260 predicted years of prospering, is written in deep-dyed characters on the page of history. Nothing can be more evident than that Babylon the Great designs the mystical city of the Papal Commonwealth, a regnant system of spiritual wickedness, an idolatrous church. This was the judgment of all the chief reformers in Germany, Switzerland, France, England, and Scotland. Some even of the Roman Catholics had the same conviction, and Petrarch, the celebrated Italian poet, calls the papal court the Babylonian harlot, mother of all idolatries. Bishop Newton, having reviewed the prophecy, says, moreover, the woman, like other harlots who give philters and love potions to inflame their lovers, hath a golden cup in her hand, full of abominations and filthiness of her fornication, to signify the specious and alluring arts wherewith she bewitcheth and inciteth men to idolatry, which is abomination and spiritual fornication. It is an image copied from Jeremiah Lee. 7. Babylon hath been a golden cup in the Lord's hand that made all the earth drunken. And is not this a much more proper emblem of pontifical than of imperial Rome? Yet farther to distinguish the woman, she has her name inscribed upon her forehead, verse 5, in allusion to the practice of some notorious prostitutes who had their names written in a label upon their foreheads. The inscription is so very particular that we cannot easily mistake the person. Mystery, Babylon the Great, the mother of harlots, or rather of fornications and abominations of the earth. Her name, Mystery, can imply no less than that she dealeth in mysteries. Her religion is a mystery of iniquity. And she herself is mystically and spiritually Babylon the Great. But the title of Mystery is in no respect proper to ancient Rome, more than any other city, and neither is there any mystery in substituting one heathen, idolatrous, and persecuting city for another. But it is indeed a mystery that a Christian city, professing and boasting herself to be the city of God, should prove another Babylon in idolatry and cruelty to the people of God. She glories in the name of Roman Catholic, and well, therefore, may she be called Babylon the Great. Infamous as the woman is for her idolatry, she is no less detestable for her cruelty, which are the two principal characteristics of the anti-Christian empire. She is drunken with the blood of the saints and with the blood of the martyrs of Jesus, Vir 6, which may indeed be applied both to pagan and to Christian Rome, for both have in their turns cruelly persecuted the saints and the martyrs of Jesus, but the latter is more deserving of the character, as she hath far exceeded the former, both in the degree and duration of her persecutions. It is very true that if Rome pagan hath slain her thousands of innocent Christians, Rome Christian hath slain her 10,000s, for not to mention other outrageous slaughters and barbarities, the Crusades against the Waldenses and Albigenses, the murders committed by the Duke of Alva in the Netherlands, the massacres in France and Ireland, will probably amount to above 10 times the number of all the Christians slain in all the 10 persecutions of the Roman emperors put together. St. John's admiration also plainly evinces that Christian Rome was intended, for it could be no matter of surprise to him that a heathen city should persecute the Christians, but that a city professedly Christian should wanton and riot in the blood of Christians was a subject of astonishment indeed, and well might he, as it is emphatically expressed, wonder with great wonder. Mr. Scott, in his commentary on 2 Thessalonians E, 3-4, remarks, "No apostasy of equal magnitude and duration, no delusions equally pernicious and abominable, have taken place since the apostles' days, as those of Rome. The imposture of Muhammad alone can be compared with it, and this could not be intended. For that impostor and his successors were not placed in the temple of God, the visible church, Reverend She, 1-2, but without it, and in direct opposition to the very name of Christianity, they propagated their delusions mainly by the sword, and not lying miracles, and indeed, the impieties of Muhammad never equaled the blasphemies here predicted. This man of Essen would be the son of perdition," John XVII. 12. A genuine descendant of Judas, the apostle and traitor, who sold his Lord for money and destroyed him with a kiss, a peculiar factor and agent of Satan in destroying the souls of men and finally sinking into perdition as his inheritance. It is manifest that no succession of men have yet appeared on earth to whom this description fully accords, except that of the Roman pontiffs. This deceiver would oppose and exalt himself above all that is called God, or is worshipped, either by Christians or pagans. Thus the Roman pontiffs have opposed the truths, commandments, and disciples of Christ in every age, the prophetical office of Christ, by teaching human inventions, his priestly office, by the doctrine of human merits and created intercessors, and his kingly office, by changing and dispensing with his laws. They have exalted themselves above all that is called God and is worshipped by claiming authority to forgive sins, by granting indulgences to men to break the commandments of God, by dispensing with his laws, and presuming to give meaning and authority to the scriptures themselves. Moreover, this man of Essen sits as God in the temple of God, and we must therefore look for him within the visible church. There he blasphemously usurps the throne of God, showing himself to be God. Many Roman emperors affected divine honors and demanded adoration, but there was no antecedent apostasy from Christianity or the worship of Jehovah, and they might rather be said to sit in the temple of Jupiter or Mars than in that of God, whose temple must be considered to be among his professed worshippers and not among avowed heathen. But the Roman pontiff, claiming to be the universal head of the whole church of God, called by his flatterers vice god, a god upon earth, arrogating the title of his holiness, boasting of infallibility, claiming a right to depose kings and bestow kingdoms on whom he pleases, answers exactly to the description here given. While the Roman pontiff opposes the worship of God by enjoining the worship of images, of saints and angels, and the authority of his laws to enforce subjection to his own edicts, he himself may be called the great idol, as well as the great tyrant, of the Romish Church. Human sagacity could by no means have conjectured such a character rising up among the people of God, and such deeds perpetrated in the name and form of religion. This required the prescience of the infinite mind. But we shall see them all in their dreadful enormity as we pursue the history of the Romish Inquisition. End of chapter. Chapter 2. Progress of Antichrist. Spirit of Antichrist. Priests, clergy, and laity, ceremonies, Mosheim, pious frauds, splendor of prelates, Constantine, the hierarchy, titles, creeds, Arianism, persecution, Rome and Constantinople, Pope John, Pope Gregory, Muhammad, claims of the Pope, Henry IV, corrupt principles. Divine wisdom having foreseen, and thus foretold, all the dreadful corruptions of the Christian Church, we are interested in marking the steps by which the progress was made. The spirit of popery we behold in the conduct of the Judaizing teachers of the early Christians, as censured by Paul, and as seen in the proceedings of Diotrephes, who is believed to have been a pastor. John complained of his refusing to receive the brethren, the messengers of the apostle, and of his malicious words, persecuting some and casting others out of the church. 2 John chapter 9, 10. This ambitious spirit led the pastors in some of the larger churches, early in the 2nd century, to assume the character and title of priests, as peculiar to their order. They claimed the privilege of being the Lord's heritage, or clergy, which belonged to the faithful, as distinct from their ministers. 1 Pet, version 31. But they persuaded the people that they had succeeded to the rights of the Jewish priesthood, as God's clergy, and hence the distinction of clergy and laity, which has no foundation in Christianity. This distinction being established gave immense force to the spirit of popery, which advanced rapidly among the ignorant people. Dr. Mosheim states, "The Christian doctors had the good fortune to persuade the people that the ministers of the Christian Church succeeded to the character, rights, and privileges of the Jewish priesthood, and this persuasion was a new source of honor and profit to the sacerdotal order. This notion was propagated with industry some time after the second destruction of Jerusalem, AD 135, had extinguished all hopes of seeing their government restored to its former luster, and their country arising from its ruins. And accordingly, the bishops considered themselves invested with a rank and character similar to those of the high priests among the Jews, while the presbyters represented the priests, and the deacons the Levites. Christianity, having no splendid ceremonial to recommend the preaching of the gospel, priests devised various forms to be added to the Lord's Supper, which was administered every Sabbath, and ceremonies were invented, partly derived from the Jews, and some from the idolaters, to attract the minds of the people, and with a view to gratify the converts from heathenism. The performance of these, especially in the Lord's Supper, served also as the means of employing the priests in their newly created offices, and they were called mysteries, as having a hidden meaning and a peculiar virtue, after the manner of the rites of the pagan priests. Hence originated the term sacraments, the Latin word for mysteries, applied to various rites, especially baptism and the Lord's Supper. Dr. Mosheim, therefore, remarks, the bishops, by an innocent allusion to the Jewish manner of speaking, had been called chief priests, the elders or presbyters had received the title of priests, and the deacons that of Levites. But in a little time, these titles were abused by an aspiring clergy who thought proper to claim the same rank and station, the same rights and privileges that were conferred with those titles upon the ministers of religion under the Mosaic dispensation. Hence the rise of tithes, first fruits, splendid garments, and many other circumstances of external.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.